Second Chance. Written by Joe Hawk. Narrated by Tristan Wright. Acknowledgements. Mick Kean, for all the days and evenings on the police boat, especially under Blue Lightning. Also for all the years in the Palm Beach Honor Guard, whether it be training or the funerals and special events, including funerals, for our fallen brothers and sisters. 4th of July, kickoff, Red Cross Ball, Policeman's Ball at Mar-a-Lago, Citizens Academy, Town Memorial and Police Week, Washington, D.C., for several years, and the friendships we made with other police officers across the country. To Mike Bates and Lori Minot, for their unselfish dedication to the burglary strike force, for the numerous hours of stakeouts and surveillance, and the takedown of a drug mule and drug dealers, the arrest of many suspects for drugs, stolen vehicles, guns, and other property, and for keeping each other safe. Lastly, for all the officers I worked with on patrol, on a daily or nightly tour of duty. Too many to mention, but thank you for having my back and keeping all of us safe so we could all go home safely after our tour of duty. Chapter 1, 1989. After submitting my resume to the town of Palm Beach, Florida for the position of police officer, I received a call from Palm Beach P.D. I was informed there was a police class starting up near the end of July. Broward Community College, Fort Lauderdale, Florida. I was told if I was still interested in the position, to come to the station and receive all the necessary paperwork. Upon arriving at the station, I was met by Sergeant Klein. He gave me all the necessary paperwork and a SNW Model 60 38 caliber revolver, a holster, and ammo. I thought that was unusual, because in New York, I had to purchase all my own equipment. This was a necessary academy course to be certified as a Florida police officer. Only 120 hours was required, instead of the normal 14 weeks for recruit police officers. I learned that there was another officer, Dave, who was also accepted to the police academy. He was currently a security guard at the Gardens Mall, Palm Beach Gardens, Florida. At the time, I was staying with a former New York City Transit Police captain, Charles Diebel. He was a friend and an extended family member, who, over the years of my employment with the New York City Transit Police Department, was his protege. So around the end of July, I traveled to Broward Community College, Monday through Saturday. I was able to hook up with David from time to time, and we commuted together. We had a few things in common. David, a former Ohio police officer with 6 years' experience, and I had 22 years with the New York City Transit Police Department. He had a set of twin boys. I had a set of twin girls. We got along just fine. The ride to Fort Lauderdale was about 70 miles, so sharing the ride was very helpful, since we weren't getting a salary. The course of study was radio codes and signals, citations and accidents, driving and firearms, very different from New York. Intense studying and memorization were necessary. Florida state statutes varied in verbiage and money amounts crimes. Funny, assault in New York was a physical offense, whereas in Florida, assault was verbal. Battery in Florida was physical. We didn't have battery in New York. One of our instructors, a traffic accident specialist, must have thought we were having an art class. He drew trees, curbs, signs, buildings, etc., to perfection. In New York, we drew a box for a car. We didn't use the ZZZ marks to show skids. The course content was different, but interesting. Arrest forms were standard, as were the traffic citations throughout Florida. Next came my favorite. Firearms qualifications. I shot a near-perfect score, but was the only one who shot a perfect score on the shoot-don't-shoot course. I was the only recruit able to do so. Saturdays were dedicated to driver training. They used skid pads, cones for backing up, pursuit driving. A lot of that goes on in Florida. Everyone seems to run from the police. So 2 weeks into training, I decided to check on my house under construction in Jupiter, Florida. I was alone in my Honda Civic, driving northbound on the Florida Turnpike. My speed was between 70 and 75 miles per hour. I was behind a white pickup truck, who was behind a North American Van Lines moving van. We were all in the right lane. Suddenly, I observed the rear wheels of the tractor-trailer jump as if it ran over something. I immediately hit my brakes, pulled to the left lane, avoiding hitting a car with Alaska plates. The white pickup truck narrowly missed the Alaska vehicle. I used vehicle instead of car. That's a southern term. The tractor-trailer struck a parked car that was on the shoulder, pulling it approximately 20 feet sideways. That vehicle exploded. The truck jackknifed, and the driver was thrown from the cab of his truck. The hit vehicle had a second explosion and was engulfed in flames. The male and I from the white pickup truck ran to the burning vehicle and extracted the woman from the vehicle through the windshield. I brought her back to the crowd, which was formed from the stalled traffic. I said, "Hold on to her." The woman screamed and said, "My family," and she ran back to her vehicle. I once again grabbed her and brought her back to the crowd of onlookers. The vehicle was engulfed in flames. I asked a motorist if he had a radio or CB radio. I said, "Tell the state police to shut down the southbound turnpike at the Jupiter exit and to bring the emergency vehicles down on the northbound side." A little while later, I observed the southbound turnpike shut down. I administered first aid to the truck driver, who said they must have pulled out from the shoulder. He also had a rider in his truck with him, who said nothing. A state trooper came to me and said he needed me to write a report of what happened. I sat in the trooper's vehicle and wrote the report, but first I said, "We need to take out a section of this divider. There are small kids and people who don't have water or food, and the traffic is backed up for miles, and it's at least 95 degrees out." As I finished the report, I observed vehicles turning south on the turnpike. A section of guardrail was removed. I didn't see that happen. I was only officially retired from New York City for 6 weeks. It felt like I never retired. A sheriff's helicopter landed on the roadway and said to the troopers that he would take pictures of the accident scene. After the woman was removed to Jupiter Hospital, they removed her husband from the vehicle. He was crushed behind the wheel. 3 children were removed from the rear seat. That was a horrific day of my life. Later that evening, I met with the traffic homicide investigator, THI, from the state police. He asked me what I observed and what actions I took and recommendations I made. When I told the trooper the vehicle was pushed sideways for 20 feet, the trooper said, "That's great. It was 19 feet. This statement was recorded. I left and drove home. I could not sleep for 3 days, thinking about what had happened. I never did get to see the house under construction. That accident happened on August 12th. Going forward, a few years later, I gave a 93-page deposition to the lawyers representing the victims of the crash. I also gave depots to the rental car company and the trucking company. The following day, after the accident, the Palm Beach Post had a front-page spread all about the accident. I didn't report my actions to the Palm Beach PD. After all, I wasn't on their payroll. I graduated from the academy on Thursday, August 31st. My first day of employment with the Palm Beach PD was Friday, September 1st. No days off. My wife eventually sold our New York house in November, and we moved into our new Florida home 3 days later. While I was at the academy, I ran into a recruit for the Broward Corrections Department. Robert was a detective with the Transit PD. Robert and I were very good friends. Plus, our wives got together on occasion. Robert and I hunted together a lot over the years. Robert was 5 years older than me, so I knew Robert had a rough time in the academy against those much younger guys than him. So now he was a Broward correctional officer. Small world running into people from your past, and in the darndest of places. So, on my first day working with Palm Beach, I pulled into the town, going across Royal Palm Way. I was awed by all the royal palms that lined the streets, and how meticulous they trimmed all the shrubbery. I had my windows open in my car. I could smell the sea breezes coming in from the ocean. It was much different than what I was used to up in New York City. There were no good-smelling sea breezes, just the smell of smog and fumes from trucks and buses. It was quite a culture shock for me. I couldn't believe how clean the town was. The streets, the sidewalks, no graffiti, nothing broken. So upon arriving at the police station, I met up with my field training officer, FTO. I'll change his name to protect the innocent. I'll call him Toby. Toby wasn't a great trainer. We drove around making house checks and business checks to satisfy his quotas, so to speak. We never stopped a vehicle, never issued a summons, a citation. I couldn't even listen to my portable police radio because it would feed over Toby's radio. And besides, listening to his car radio talk show was more important to him, but he did know where to get a free lunch and coffee. 2 weeks with Toby was just plain boredom. Week number 3 and 4 proved more interesting. I was hooked up with an FTO that was also a motorcycle officer, and he was cool. He said, "What do you want to do?" I said, "I haven't stopped a vehicle, I haven't driven a car, nor issued any citations." He pulled to the side of the roadway and said, "Okay, you drive." He said, "If you see a violation, conduct a traffic stop." Later that day, I made 3 traffic stops, issued 1 citation and 2 written warnings for equipment violations. Things were looking up. For the next 2 weeks, I learned the zones and hotspots. I got a good handle on the makeup of the town. Jim was a pleasure to ride with. We exchanged stories and talked about our families. He was a seasoned officer and an adept field training officer. 2 weeks later, I was assigned a female FTO, Gail. She was the best, really. She tested me on my radio codes, paperwork, streets, hotels, and restaurants. She gave me helpful hints on streets that sounded like similar names. For example, Sea View, Sea Spray, Sea Breeze. To remember their order, Gail would say, "See the view, feel the spray, and the breeze." We worked the midnight shift. One early morning before getting off from work, a call came in from a landing of Haitians, 1800 block South Ocean Boulevard. We responded and saw Haitians running everywhere. A couple of cars responded as well. Gail and I grabbed 3 females and 3 males. I said, "Put the 3 females in our vehicle and the 3 males in the other vehicle, so we don't have to run after them." She said, "Good idea." We rounded up 4 more, and a perimeter was set up to capture 2 more that ran southbound on South Ocean Boulevard. They kept a perimeter for a few hours, and the 2 males were caught at the Lake Worth Bridge. Border Patrol responded and took custody of all the illegals, totaling 12. I enjoyed working with Gail. She seemed to know everyone in town, including the store clerks. She told me she was a patrol officer that patrolled Worth Avenue. That's how she knew all these store workers. The department finally let her become a police officer after about 6 years' employment with the town. At the time, there was another female officer who left on maternity leave but never returned. They said I was her replacement for the midnight shift. Since I had prior law enforcement experience, I only had to be in the training program for 6 weeks. Another officer, Mary, who was in the academy, got released from the FTO program about the same time as I did. So she had 1 seniority over me. I stayed on midnights. She went to 4 to 12 p.m. I said, "I must admit there was a lot of activity on mids, if you wanted it." And I did. I was assigned mostly Zone 1, the south end, or Zone 5, the north end. Not too much in the middle. Oh well. I liked the activity. I felt like I was doing something to earn a paycheck. From October to December 31st, I was involved in a few noteworthy police actions. One outstanding police action that comes to mind was on November 3rd, 1989, about 6 o'clock a.m. I was checking my zone before going for coffee. I was driving southbound on South Ocean Boulevard, and I noticed a vehicle pulled over on the shoulder in the 1700 block. The driver, later ID'd as Mr. Evans, was slumped over the steering wheel and was having difficulty breathing. I opened Mr. Evans' airway and called for the paramedics to respond. According to subsequent reports from Mr. Evans' doctor, he had suffered a massive heart attack, and had he not been located and given first aid quickly, the heart attack would have been fatal. For that action, the Palm Beach Police Department awarded me with a life-saving ribbon and designated me as Officer of the Month for December 1989. The FOP gave me a check for $100 at their monthly meeting in January 1990, and a plaque. The chief of the department gave me a very nice congratulatory letter for my performance and saving a man's life. I felt like I was given a second chance to work in a profession that I so loved. In the northern states, police departments did not want to hire you over the age of 35. I guess they felt that you weren't as good as someone much younger. I figured what they didn't realize was education and experience come with age, as well as wisdom. The feds also have a policy in by 35, out by 55. So coming to South Florida, I had the opportunity to do what I loved doing for the previous 22 years. A law enforcement police officer. So, in my opinion, that was a second chance to do it over again. Course of study. J. Edgar Hoover, FBI. Director stated, Learn more about law enforcement professions. Acquiring knowledge is a never-ending process. So, I will list the courses of studies for each year that I attended extra training and knowledge. 1. Basic Recruit Certificate. Certificate of Compliance for Law Enforcement Officers, 120 hours, September 1st, 1989. 2. Semi-Automatic Pistol Familiarization Course, December 1989. Chapter 2, 1990. After I received my first commendation in Officer of the Month, I was highly motivated to perform to the best of my abilities. I was additionally motivated because I was considerably older than my fellow officers, and I wanted to show that age and experience can be assets in police work. January, I, along with the other six officers on Shift 1, received a shift-level commendation from my Lieutenant Dan Kelly. As a team, we made a total of 53 felony and misdemeanor arrests, seizing marijuana and cocaine with a street value of $700 and recovering stolen property valued at $77,000. In addition, through our innovative teamwork, we seized 5 motor vehicles for forfeiture purposes. We had made 32 arrests for criminal traffic violations as well. The commendation credited our shift for generating and corroborating criminal intelligence information, targeting and establishing surveillances, and subsequently making arrests for burglaries, grand theft, and narcotic sales. By our work, the PBPD and AUKVAN agents obtained the basis of probable cause for the execution of narcotic search warrants. From February 1st through February 28th, we also made a total of 41 adult and 8 juvenile arrests, which was an increase of 1,950% and 300% respectively, over the same period before. I, Joe Hawk, started in September of 1989 and led all the other Palm Beach PD units and patrol shifts by a 4-to-1 margin. We were accredited by Lieutenant Kelly, Sergeant Bill, and Sergeant Hutchins to exhibit ingenuity, proactive patrol, and aggressive professionalism, and esprit de corps, the dedication to the team approach, rarely observed in any of their experiences among officers, working the mentally and physically fatiguing hours between midnight and sunrise. I credit ourselves to be able to accomplish the above works by drinking lots and lots of coffee. In between busy nights, I patrolled my zone with diligence. I made some traffic stops, and subsequently that led to some narcotics arrests, mostly marijuana. Some weeks I would be assigned to Zone 5, which was the north end of town. There wasn't any stores or coffee shops, strictly homes. Some were mansions. Most of the calls were alarm calls. People forgot to turn off their alarms when they came home. 2 officers would respond. Sometimes you had to wait a while until your backup officer arrived. There were set procedures how to identify exactly where you were according to the makeup of the structure. They would say, "I'm on Site 2, Corner 3. The responding backup officer would know exactly where you were. Zone 5 officers would check the inlet dock, which was the northernmost end of Palm Beach. They would check to see if there were illegal parking or people fishing on the dock, in violation of town ordinances, close at 9 p.m. Some people would fish on the property of a closed house, and when challenged, they would say the homeowner gave them permission. When asked what the homeowner's name was, and they couldn't answer that question, they were booted off the property with a trespass warning citation. We also checked the beach area for illegal boat landings of immigrants coming from the Bahamas. There were many landings over the years. The first landings were by Cubans. They would come by raft or tire tubes, tied or fastened together. I must say, there were many who didn't make it. The government had a policy, dry foot, wet foot. If a Cuban made landfall, he could stay. If he was captured in the water, he was returned to Cuba. The Cubans had to have been desperate to attempt the 90-mile trip from Cuba to the USA via an inner tube. I guess they were looking for a second chance in life, to live in freedom instead of oppression. My hat goes off to them. I was issued a shift-level commendation along with Police Officer Ira for a very interesting investigation that led to the arrest of 3 males. It all began on April 23rd, around 2 a.m. The victim claimed, on or about that time, he was robbed of his valuables that contained his wallet and wrist bracelet by 3 armed white males. He was unable to provide a description of the suspect's vehicle, only that they exited a small vehicle before they robbed him. Upon my arriving in the area, I was given limited information. I recalled the vehicle I had seen around the time of the robbery and provided some partial registration information to the communications unit for computer checks. Officer Ira began getting additional information from the victim. I began an area search in the general vicinity of the robbery. When I completed the canvas of the area, I responded to the station to meet with Officer Ira. Upon viewing the victim, I advised Officer Ira that I observed the victim in a small red Buick in the alleged robbery, with three male subjects at approximately 2 a.m., and I could only recall the vehicle's tag contained the letter Z. I also advised Officer Ira I had spoken to the driver of the vehicle and that I could identify him. I remembered the driver stated he was looking for a friend by the name of George. Officer Ira told me that the victim told him that they were looking for a friend at the time of the robbery. After I described the vehicle in greater detail, I looked at Ira's report. Officer Ira checked his daily notebook and advised me that he too had observed the same vehicle in the robbery prior to 2 a.m. Ira was able to provide the correct vehicle tag to the communications unit as a possible suspect vehicle. When the vehicle registration matched that of the vehicle and the victim had been observed in by me, the vehicle became the only lead in the case. When Detective Morris came on duty, before I went off duty, I filled him in on the details of the case. I said I could identify the driver of the vehicle. Detective Morris asked me if I wanted to work the case with him. I readily complied. We were able to track the subjects to a hotel in West Palm Beach, by the mall, from the use of the victim's credit card. We set up in the hotel's first floor. We were advised the suspects were in a room on the second floor of the hotel, and I observed the driver of the vehicle enter the hotel and go up to the second floor. We followed the suspect and went into the room behind him. We arrested the driver and the second male suspect in the room. We were informed that the third male was shopping in the mall for sundries. We handcuffed the two suspects and waited for the third male, who arrived within half hour. We recovered the victim's wallet, credit card, wrist bracelet, and knife. All three suspects were transported to Palm Beach Police Department for arrest processing of armed robbery. Officer Ira and I were commended for our part in the investigation. Within 12 hours of the initial report, all three suspects were arrested, and all the property of the victim was recovered, including the knife used in the robbery. The lieutenant wrote that through teamwork, cooperation, and excellent patrol techniques by all those involved, this case was brought to a timely and successful conclusion. And without the cooperation and teamwork of those involved, he believed that this case would not have been brought to a successful conclusion. One evening in July at approximately 5 p.m., I was patrolling the Southern Boulevard, Causeway. I was observing vehicles entering and leaving Palm Beach. I could see some fishermen fishing off a small bridge just east of the main bridge. I also observed a male on a two-wheeled bike riding eastbound toward the ocean. A few hours later, it was getting dark. I observed the same male on the bike riding westbound on the causeway. He did not have a light on his bike. As he passed, I put my blue lights on to conduct a vehicle stop. A bicycle in Florida is considered a vehicle under Florida state statutes. He failed to pull over. I engaged my siren and loudspeaker. He still refused. I pulled alongside of him. He eluded by riding his bicycle toward the intracoastal waterway. I thought he was going to jump in. I exited my vehicle, ran down the small hill to the water's edge, and stopped him. I asked him why he didn't stop. He said, "I didn't do anything wrong. I was just talking to the fishermen." I said, "No, you weren't. I saw you ride right past them." I asked him his name and address. He hesitated and gave a fictitious name, verified later at the station. I noticed that the suspect had only 9 fingers. I observed a burlap bag tied to the bike support bar. There were small puffy perforations with an egg-like shape. My backup officer arrived, and she said, "They are turtle eggs." The burlap bag had sand all over it. The suspect also had sand on his forearms, as though he was digging in the sand. I further noticed a liquid oozing from the burlap bag as if it was a broken egg or two. I asked the male what he had in the bag, and he wouldn't say. Probable cause existed to where I could examine the bag. It contained turtle eggs. I placed the male under arrest and confiscated his bike. He was transported to the police station, where he was fingerprinted and photographed. When his prints came back, he was ID'd as Alvin Meal. The prints noted he had 9 fingers. Mr. Meal was charged with possession of 342 marine-protected turtle eggs, no light on his bicycle, resisting arrest, fleeing, and eluding a police officer. An officer from Wildlife, Fish, and Game responded and noted that the eggs contained both green turtles and leatherback turtle eggs, which were both endangered species. They took possession of the eggs and stated they will calibrate each egg to determine how many green turtles and leatherback eggs were there. I made many trips to the Assistant United States Attorney's Office to assist in the prosecution of this arrest. Mr. Meal was a frequent flyer to possess endangered turtle eggs. I testified in the suppression evidence hearing. All 11 counts of my observation, trying to stop the bike with no light, to identify the suspect and subsequently identifying endangered sea turtle eggs. All criminal charges were upheld by the federal magistrate. In October, I received a letter from the Assistant United States Attorney in reference to the turtle egg poacher that I arrested in July. He stated, "Officer Joe Hawk recently testified at suppression of evidence hearing. Joe's demeanor and professionalism impressed both him and the judge. In addition, he wrote that Joe met him on several occasions on his own time, in preparation of the case. As a result of his diligent police work, his office was able to successfully prosecute the defendant. Mr. Meal was sentenced to 30 months in federal prison, which was the stiffest sentence in this country's history for possession of endangered turtle eggs." Evaluations of officers were done on a yearly basis. Your date when you entered the department. So for me, it was September 1 of that year. So my first evaluation would be on or about September 1st, 1990. There were categories in which officers were evaluated. Based on your evaluation, you got a pay raise. It was pay for performance. One category was additional schools or classes to improve your knowledge or investigative techniques. Generally, you weren't permitted to take educational classes until you had 1 year on the job. You had to be off probation, but you could take classes that help you with patrol, for instance, radar, laser, etc. So I put in for a radar course on my own time. It consisted of classroom and on-the-job training, whereby you would run the radar and make a log. You had to be able to calculate the speed of the vehicle within 5 miles of its speed. So you observe the vehicle, and you judge its speed to be, let's say, 40 miles per hour. You point the radar gun, and you see what the radar reading is. It can be 35 or as high as 45. Over the estimated speed is always better. After a while, you get good at it. So we have 40 hours of class instruction, and a test is given. A vehicle is set up in a stationary position, and when a speeding car is observed, you tell the instructor you believe the vehicle is going, for example, 40 miles per hour. He shoots the radar gun at the vehicle, and if you're within 5 miles each time, you pass the test. He was certified to take the radar gun and write summons for speeding. You wouldn't be able to do that if you weren't certified. Now you had another tool to make arrests. I received a passing grade of 88%. When you went into court, because someone pleads not guilty, you have to show your certificate, your log for that day, and show you calibrated the radar gun with tuning forks, and explain your case to the magistrate. 98 out of 100 times, you will win your case. On July 28th, my son's birthday, an unprecedented event occurred in the town of Palm Beach. The Ku Klux Klan, KKK, and their Nazi colleagues, the Skinheads, received a permit from the town to march down Worth Avenue, and end up at Memorial Fountain, located opposite the police station. This event was the result of a federal court order enabling this demonstration. Intelligence shared by other agencies and the Palm Beach Police Department indicated that there was going to be massive media publicity given this event. We all anticipated a large counter-demonstration by various groups. As a direct result of the intelligence that was gathered, appropriate measures were taken to ensure the safety of the marchers, anti-demonstrators, and police officers. There was a total of 140 police officers assembled from 7 law enforcement agencies, including Palm Beach personnel. I later learned that every single Palm Beach officer except one who was out of state participated and reported for duty in order to carry out the police department mission, which is to protect life and property. Approximately 1,000 counter-demonstrators were present along with 30 Klan and Nazi marchers. Klansmen and skinheads mingled throughout the crowd for the purpose of brewing and stirring up trouble. Undercover officers were spread out amongst the crowd to take out and take down the agitators that were stirring up violence. The uniformed officers, including myself, walked alongside of the Klan marchers to form a barrier against the counter-demonstrators. They did maintain order. There was no loss of life, limb, or property damage, with the exception of slight damage to the Klan's leader's limousine. They had police personnel on the police station's roof, taking videos of the demonstrators at Memorial Fountain. There was a police helicopter hovering over the area, also taking videos of the demonstration. I observed the helicopter from the local TV station. The uniformed officers, myself included, walked alongside the Klan marchers to perform a barrier against the counter demonstrators. In retrospect, coming from New York City, I heard about the Klan and the atrocities that they were noted for, hiding behind a hood, shielding their identity. I never imagined myself being assigned to protect the safety of a group of lowlifes that committed numerous atrocities on the week. All the participating officers received a congratulatory letter from the town of Palm Beach police chief and the town manager. My son had a very happy and memorable birthday. I had a memorable day that I won't forget either. Speaking of birthdays, on my birthday, August 22nd, I received a complimentary letter from the police chief for my assistance of a resident who sustained a blow out of his tire while driving on South Ocean Boulevard. I called for a tow truck and remained with the resident until he was able to drive away in his vehicle. In September, I received another congratulatory letter from the town's mayor, who was very grateful for my fast response to her home alarm going off. My lieutenant and I responded and conducted a thorough search of her property. It turned out to be a malfunction of the alarm system. The mayor told my lieutenant that she was in favor of hiring older, experienced police officers. She was happy to note I was one. A few weeks later, I enrolled in a crime scene photography class, now that I was off probation. The class consisted of 40 hours, and we were instructed and tested on how to feed the film in the camera, all about f-stops, lights, stillness, shutter speeds, etc. We spent a lot of time in the darkroom, developing the film, of pictures that we took. I took pictures of my vehicle, house, dog, and everything in between. I had my own Pentax camera. The course culminated on November 20th, so it took 2 months to finish the course. It came in handy when I had the opportunity to take crime scene photos of vehicle accidents. Also, it helped in taking profile pictures of arrest suspects. The following 2 months were unnewsworthy. I spent that time patrolling the north end of the island and being observant to who drove what cars. I also checked to see that all the garages were closed. You would be surprised to learn how many were left open at night. Everyone was getting ready for the up-and-coming holidays. People would bring in large amounts of food to the police station for all the police personnel. I was never used to being treated in such a respectful manner. The residents really cared for their police officers. Courses of study. 1. Radar operator, May 23rd to June 1st, 1990. 40 hours. 2. Crime scene photography, September 18th to November 20th, 1990. 40 hours. Chapter 3. 1991. I started off the new year in 1991 with some citizen commendations. Palm Beach Police Department is truly a service-oriented department, helping its citizenry in every capacity possible. Some agencies would view this as very minor and would rather not get involved. The department recognizes that when people need assistance, regardless of what someone else perceives as immaterial and a waste of their time, I have better things to do with my time attitude. Palm Beach does the opposite. They encourage their officers to help, assist, and aid their residents or visitors with the utmost professionalism possible. So I'll just list a few of those, as other officers might describe as a waste of my time. 1. February 12th. A female needed assistance with harassing phone calls and a stolen wallet. She felt that she was prevaricated by the Riviera Beach Police Department and the County Department. Their excuse was, it's not our jurisdiction, even though the original incident took place on Military Trail and 45th Street. She stated she was a resident for 4 years. In too many cases, the good is never heard, only the bad. So she felt she wanted to compliment me on my professionalism. I filed a report for her and did a follow-up phone call the next day to see how she was. She stated to my chief that she greatly appreciated the follow-up call. She further stated that if she had any further calls for service, that Officer Joe would respond or someone with the same disposition. In closing, she stated that if we had more officers that were courteous, professional, and down-to-earth like Officer Joe Hawk, the people would be more apt to appreciate their efforts and work with them instead of against them. Congratulations on having such a person in your department. 2. A personal letter dated February 21st from an employee from a local church. She stated she was working in the office when a resident came in and stated she couldn't find her keys, so she called the Palm Beach police. I responded to the call for assistance. She stated the purpose of her letter is to tell the chief how kind and gracious I was to the resident in distress. She stated, Officer Joe stayed with the resident until the problem was resolved and her keys were found. She said Officer Joe was so good and patient with her. That was trivial to most, but very appreciative from the resident who had no way of getting into her apartment without her keys. 3. March 19th, twin daughter's birthday. A worker for a bank called to say she locked her keys in her vehicle. I responded and was able to gain entry. The woman noted to the chief that Officer Joe was very helpful and very friendly. She wanted to tell the chief that she worked in Palm Beach, and she always had a wonderful relationship with all the officers. They are always prompt and helpful in all matters. Thanks again to your department. 4. March 25th. A resident of Chicago wrote to say she was parked opposite the police station and locked her keys in her vehicle. Her friend suggested they go into the police station for assistance, which she did. She said, she picked up the wall phone and spoke to a dispatcher, who seemed to be concerned with her problem. The dispatcher stated an officer would be at her vehicle in a few minutes. The woman stated that officer, Joe Hawk, was attempting to open her vehicle and not willing to stop until the door was open. She noted Officer Joe finally opened her door. She was impressed with the overall service she received. She stated she loved Palm Beach and loved her visit there, and I feel that we get the best of care. 5. April 27th. A letter of thanks from a West Palm Beach resident thanking Officer Joe for getting into her locked vehicle. She went on to say that she appreciated his patience and persistence and sense of humor in spite of the heat. Sincerely, Kathleen. 89 Red Beretta. Officer Joe said, if I had more patience, I would be a doctor. 6. One last one for now. June 13th. A resident of Palm Beach Gardens wrote a note of thanks for assisting him on a Sunday. He stated he was driving south on North County Road. He realized he was getting a flat tire, so he pulled over and was getting ready to change the tire when Officer Joe appeared and asked if he could be of assistance. He stated Joe changed the tire for him, and he said that he was 75 years of age. I can tell you, his efforts were greatly appreciated, that I got the assistance that I needed. Ralph W. So, as you can see, I made 6 very happy citizens, very grateful for the services of the Palm Beach Police Department. Gratitude from citizens is most rewarding. They remember the good and the bad. Hopefully, it is mostly good. And really, what did it cost me? A little of my time, which I'm getting paid for. Patience, perseverance, that doesn't cost anything. But self-gratification, and knowing you help someone, hoping if your family member was in distress, they would receive the same kindness, understanding, and patience given to them. Not only do I help citizens, but fellow officers in arresting perpetrators of crimes. So on the evening of June 16th, my grandmother's birthday, at approximately 10:45 p.m., an officer was dispatched to the Breakers Hotel in reference to 3 subjects who earlier in the day were involved in the theft of services to the hotel by using a stolen credit card. It was learned that one of these suspects was last seen running south from the main entrance of Breakers Row. Responding officers immediately set up a perimeter in the immediate area. One officer spotted a male exiting out of the bushes who matched the description of one of the subjects seen earlier. The male was arrested for loitering and prowling and processed at headquarters. Since the subject fit a composite sketch of the person using the stolen credit card, the assigned detective showed the witness his picture, which they picked out of a 6-pack, 6 pictures of a similar featured individual. The male was additionally charged with grand theft, as he had charged over $4,000 worth of merchandise and services at the hotel. All the involved officers in this matter received a shift-level commendation for the quick response and the effective establishment of a perimeter, which resulted in the arrest of a felon. During the latter part of July, there were 2 burglaries and larceny crimes committed in the same block of High Mount Road. Officers stopped a late-model pickup truck occupied by 3 white males, containing a washer and dryer in the bed of the truck. After issuing a traffic citation to the driver, the information was given to the detective bureau, along with the other names of the passengers of the truck. A detective interviewed 2 of the alleged suspects. The detectives assigned the Special Investigative Unit, SIU, to perform a stakeout and surveillance of the area, which was an area for younger people to hang out. So myself and my female partner, who were the SIU stakeout team, staked out the area from 11 o'clock p.m. till dawn. During that time, we observed a pickup truck occupied by two white males and matching a description of the truck stopped prior by a fellow police officer. When the pickup truck pulled up to a vacant house, we maintained our surreptitious cover. We directed units to respond to set up a strategic advantage, if and when the suspects might flee the area. We observed the two males unload two large appliances from the truck and then attempt to leave. My partner and I followed the vehicle off the property and directed the other units to close in. We conducted a felony traffic stop and arrested the two males. They were charged with burglary, possession of a burglar's tools, trespass, two counts of theft, and conspiracy. Also arrested was a white female as being a lookout. She was charged with conspiring and accessory after the fact. She was boxed in during the initial traffic stop. The detectives did a follow-up investigation and additionally charged that suspect with charges of burglary, and they recovered additional items from other thefts at the residence, which SIU staked out that evening. The above incident awarded my partner and I with a shift-level commendation. I said the above incident would have not had the same outcome if the assisting officers weren't there for our backup. A few weeks later, in the middle part of August, myself and another officer were assigned to travel to the Palm Bay Police Department for a two-day class. The class was for U.S. Customs cross-training course. The officers were instructed by a few custom agents in the federal laws and how to conduct boat stops while stationary or moving and where to locate places where drugs were hidden. They saw videos of drug seizures, whereby sections of boats were cut in half to locate the drugs. They explained, just like when you run a license plate, so a boat registration reveals whether the boat or vessel was used in the transport of drugs. In addition, officers were instructed on boarding buses and planes if necessary, interviewing suspects, what to watch for. We were instructed on signs people display when they are stopped and questioned. If they are carrying contraband, they become very nervous and sometimes sweat for no reason other than they are carrying something illegal. The two-day course was very inspiring. The custom agents are under the guidance of U.S. Department of the Treasury. The police department would conduct operations under the flag of Blue Lightning. The officers that qualified as custom agents were able to conduct and assist the police boat captains during Operation Blue Lightning. I was involved in many Blue Lightning maneuvers. We boarded boats that were on the list of transporting drugs at one time or another. Our Palm Beach boat officers did stop a boat that had some 88 kilos of cocaine. I believe that that was our department's largest seizure at the time. Every so often, myself and the boat captain would meet up at midnight with a custom officer and go out in his boat, which is a go-fast boat, confiscated in seizure, that had twin 440 six-pack engines. It was fast. My partners and I would go out 10 miles from the Jupiter Inlet, all blacked out. I didn't know how high the seas were. One night we were moving at a very fast rate, when all of a sudden the captain says, "Oh, shoot!" I soon learned what he meant. We were airborne. Literally, we were completely out of the water. He said, "Hold on!" We sat in a boat 10 miles east of land. We had a semi-automatic weapon and an MP5 machine gun. Drug dealers could easily toss a hand grenade into the boat if they were pulled over, so we had to be prepared for the worst. We bobbed around in the water till about 5 a.m., listening for high-speed boats or small planes that could drop bales of marijuana or cocaine into the ocean, to be retrieved by drug smugglers. I had to admit, we didn't encounter any drug smugglers during my time working with the custom agents. Overall, it was a great experience. As they say, surveillance is a lonely tour of duty, but the three of us got to know each other, and the time passed. I suggested we should bring a fishing pole the next time. They didn't think that was a good idea. My advice, if you are dealt lemons, make lemonade. I took 2 weeks' vacation to visit my two sons in New York. It was a welcome break from work. The rest of the family wanted to visit their brothers before school started back up, so they had a few days to explore New York City. Then it was time to make the drive back to Florida. Then it was business as usual. The end of October, I enrolled in a street narcotics enforcement class run by the Sheriff's Department. It was headed by a former NYPD officer who worked in Midtown South Precinct in New York City. the area where I previously worked for numerous years. It was a 4-day course for visiting agencies, but 5 days for the sheriff's deputies. The 5th day was procedures for arresting, transporting, confiscating property, and seizures of vehicles or other property. The other agencies didn't have to go through that, as they work with them, and they handled all the vouchering, case numbers, and transportation of the prisoners. The advantage to other jurisdictions was that their agencies shared in the seizure monies from the arrest of drug dealers or buyers. Myself and my partner did jump outs, with the sheriff's department, on a number of occasions. We covered areas of Lake Worth and West Palm Beach. The experience we received from the 32-hour course assisted officers on surveillance techniques. We were able to better blend in, so as not to be noticed by the alleged suspects or future felons. We learned how to play off from looking like a cop. In New York, I too used to observe people, how they dressed, how they walked, and if they were carrying a weapon. Just by the walk or gait, one could tell if he was a Jamaican. They had large feet. When they walked, they strutted, throwing their feet out to the side with a elongated walk. A Jewish man would walk with his feet on a 45-degree angle, like a duck, so to speak. Chinese men and women take small steps. Indians place one foot in front of the other. This helps when you are looking for a suspect. If a witness is asked the above questions, how he walked, it can narrow down a lot of people. Not many detectives ask that question because they didn't make these kinds of observations, but when you do surveillances, it's what we do. My wife and I were out for a drive in West Palm Beach on a Saturday morning. I was stopped at a light and I looked to my left. There was a male in front of a store, in this small shopping plaza. I said to my wife, "See that male in the red shirt? He just got out of jail." She said, "How do you know?" I said, "Watch him. He takes 8 steps forward, turns around, and walks 8 steps back. He keeps repeating this," I said. "That's the size of a jail cell." She was amazed at what you can learn by being observant. November was right around the corner. I had signed up for a 40-hour investigative interviews course at the Palm Beach Community College. Since it was an advanced course, there was role-playing, whereby you would interview suspects or witnesses or victims to get enough information for a detailed report, and enough to start an investigation to identify the suspects, which would eventually lead to an arrest and conviction. It explained procedures on how to interview suspects and warning signs of deception. How they divert their eyes from the interviewer. When they look up, they are searching for an answer. When they look down, it is a sign of guilt or deception. Remember, I quoted J. Edgar Hoover, FBI, "Learn more about law enforcement professions. Acquiring knowledge is a never-ending process, so the more you know, the better you become." And that's everything in life, not just law enforcement. Learn your tools of the trade to make you better. I effected a few narcotics arrests from people frequenting the local bars in Palm Beach. People would park at Publix Market after it closed, drink and light up marijuana. Some would do lines of cocaine, and my partner and I, Sheila, would blend in, and not taking her for a police officer. She would observe most of the arrests. I would move in for backup and the arrest. If it was just a marijuana cigarette, we could write the arrest form and issue a date to come to court. We did this away from their onlookers so as not to give ourselves up and blow our cover. We would change shirts so as not to be identified as the officer wearing a red shirt. Some nights we made multiple arrests. Before going off duty, the marijuana was field-tested on the spot to ensure they had a lawful arrest. We vouched the property at the police station at the end of our shift. One night, an officer wrote an intelligence report stating she found an empty glassine envelope in the vicinity of a well-known restaurant. Well, my partner and I staked out the vicinity, and we too found an empty glassine envelope. We managed to get up to the roof by a public staircase. We secreted ourselves on the roof, in an area that we could observe anyone coming up to the roof. It wasn't long when we observed an employee of the restaurant light up a marijuana cigarette from a stash that he had. If you could see the expression on his face when we showed him our police shields and told him he was under arrest. Since he had a quantity of marijuana, he was transported to the station in order to properly weigh the marijuana to see if in fact it was felony weight, over 20 grams, which it was just under. So we issued him a notice to appear in county court and vouched the marijuana and sent him on his way. Hopefully, not back to work. The holidays were once again upon us, and I spent a lot of time on Worth Avenue, working days to ensure there was peace and tranquility amongst the shoppers. When Santa Claus and Mrs. Claus came down Worth Avenue on a fire truck, my partner and I hung around the large crowds of people looking for pickpockets or others attempting a retail theft. The street was closed to vehicle traffic until a few hours after the huge Christmas tree was lit. Most years, the crowd was very orderly. There were approximately 20 police officers that worked the Christmas detail, including plainclothes officers. So basically, another year came to a close. Hopefully, 1992 would bring good tidings. Course of study. 1. U.S. Customs Service, Customs Officer. August 14, 1991. 16 hours. 2. Street Narcotics Enforcement, Sheriff's Department. October 25, 1991. 32 hours. 3. Investigative Interviews. PB Com Call. November 4th through the 8th, 1991. 40 hours. Chapter 4. 1992. January, my SIU partner was still very active in arresting drug users.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.